Okay, so I just want to say a few words about some result that surprised us actually, which we just posted on the archive, which suggests evidence for hidden is missing here, relativistic jets in non-relativistic supernova. So we have supernova that don't show any indication of relativistic activity and not associated with gamma ray burst or so on. And at the same time, we know that there is a hidden jet inside. And the observation, these are the observations. This is the classical sample from a paper by Mazzali et al. Supernova 97EF. So some of the data is actually quite old. What is new is the interpretation. And this is a fit of the density versus velocity profile of this supernova. And the fit here is what you expect from a classical standard spherical supernova or standard supernova. And but the spectroscopy forces this model, and this looks like a small difference, but there is a huge amount of energy here. So this is an excess of material at more than about 30,000 kilometers per second. So this was seen 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6 supernova. This is what you expect from a spherical shock. A steep decrease of the energy as a function of the velocity. And we have taken all the supernova and normalized them because each supernova has its own curve. But so this is the profile of energy as a function of velocity. And you expect a very steep decrease just from the propagation of the shock wave, spherical shock wave in a decreasing atmosphere. So there is this issue that less and less material is accelerated to higher velocity, but at the end there is very small amount of material moving at very high velocity, and this is expressed by this curve. And this is what was observed in all these supernova, this excess here. So this was the observations, which some of it was since 97, and this was an observation which was waiting for an explanation. And I want to stress that this was early days. So what is the evidence is that if this is the bulk of the supernova ejecta, then there is an outer layer which is expanding more rapidly in the outer region of the supernova, not necessarily separated, but this is the outer part of this ejecta. And at early days, this is optically thick, so we can, not optically thick, this is not completely transparent. So if there are absorption lines here, we can see that from the absorption line, we can measure the velocity of this material. As time goes on, this expands, this becomes sufficiently thin that the lines cannot be observed anymore. So this signature disappears, and you cannot see it if you're looking at supernova more than 5 or 6 days or a week after the event. So in this supernova, for example, if you look later on, and there was a couple of other observations, this excess of high velocity material disappeared, not because it was not there, but because it could not be observed. And this is important because there is a very small sample of supernova that have early enough spectra that could reveal this, because if the spectra is not early enough, you cannot see. So what's the explanation?
Can you say, are these all stripped envelopes? What kind of supernova are these?
Okay, I'll get to it in a second. But the quick answer is, most of them are 1Bs, and there is one is 1C, and there is also 2B. So there is also type 2. So almost as regular as possible, but slightly straight. And this is also consistent with this picture. So what's the basic idea? The basic idea is that this was shown before, that there is a jet, and the jet propagates inside the star. It's a relativistic jet, and all the energy of this jet dissipates at the shock at the head, and it produces a cocoon. And if the jet is choked before it gets out, so this jet disappears, but it leaves a hot cocoon, a hot cocoon which contains all the energy that the jet had before the jet died. Now, what happens to this cocoon? What you saw here, you see here, is a simulation of such an event. The jet propagated basically up to here, and it died out when it was here. And what we see here is the moment that the cocoon breaks out. So the cocoon by itself is hot enough, and it breaks out from the star. And if you wait long enough, this is not the same scale, it's much larger scale, the material from the cocoon spread around this, the whole supernova. So it's spread almost spherically around the supernova, and this is the hot material that we see. And I want to stress that I don't know, this is a statement about me, it's not a statement about nature, and also about my co-authors, we don't know how to produce such an excess in any other way. I mean, definitely not by keeping the spherical symmetry.
I was about to ask you, what if you start playing with the progenitor structure, with the asphericity of the progenitor structure?
Asphericity of the progenitor will not be sufficient, but actually evidence for this is seen from the fact that the structure of many supernova shows non-sphericity. Mm-hmm. So if you look at this picture here, this picture is not completely spherical, and if you look at it, it may give you indication of sphericity. So this is the supernova in the sample. This is well known, it's the GRB supernova. This is the first one that I mentioned here, no GRB. This is a very nearby supernova, which was looked from every possible direction. It's only 8 megaparsec. Absolutely no evidence for an afterglow or anything like this. And still we have this phenomena. And this is the famous 2000 AD. Still you have this phenomena. And this is type 2B. And what you see here is the energy which is involved. And you can see there is quite a lot of energy. There's quite a lot of energy. Not sufficient energy to, these are all powerful supernova. There is not sufficient energy there to blow up the supernova, but it's comparable. It's 10, 20, 25% of the total energy of the supernova. And in some cases, we can even estimate the mass of the ejector. So there is a small mass, but with quite high velocity and quite a lot of energy. So this is what we find. And the next step is to think about multi-messenger signals. What does it mean? First of all, it means that these supernova engines were fastly rotating to produce the jet. They were not the usual supernova engine that we discussed. And this may mean that we may have to rethink about the possibility of gravitational radiation from regular supernova, not GRB associated supernova or something like this. And the second thing is that if we look at its structure, we have the shocks here and there, and it may be very well possible that these shocks produce high energy neutrinos. It's not so clear because at first guess, this both shocks are radiation dominated, so it is not clear if this radiation dominated shocks can produce neutrinos, but it is very promising. But definitely in the context of our conference here, the possibility of having much stronger gravitational wave from regular supernova is very, very exciting. This to me. Thank you.
So I was gonna channel my inner Thomas Yanko. So he would say that, you know, even in non-jet powered supernova, there can be like asymmetries, you know, that the convective eddies that blow up the star may be sort of bipolar. So you're suggesting much stronger asymmetries than you might get if you just had a neutrino mechanism, but you sort of had two. It was sort of on small scales, very asymmetric. I mean, I guess I'm trying to, yeah.
Well, this observation is consistent with few other observations. This is consistent with the fact that many supernova that we observe are not spherical. It is also consistent with the fact that some supernova remnants that we observe are not spherical. So there is a lot of supporting evidence for this from other things, but it's very different from this from the mechanism that you mentioned, because to produce this we need ordered motion. This jet are ordered motion, and if the matter that we see is moving at 0.1 c, this means that the jet is much more moved much faster. I don't know how faster it could be. The simplest guess is that since the energy of these jets resembles the energy of GRB jets, the simplest guess is that they are just like GRB jets, and the envelope was somewhat larger, and this is what killed the jet, and it did not escape and produce a GRB. So this is the simplest guess, and in this case, this will be 100 Lorentz factor of 100 or something like this. But this is a guess. We don't have any clue on what is the real velocity apart from the fact that it's more than 0.16.
So, in this case, what controls the GRB and the supernovae?
The size of the star.
Yeah. Okay.
It could be a small difference between two different stars. Will make the big difference between a jet that escapes and a jet that does not escape.
So you prefer the scenario where the jet is more common, right? So the size of the star is more important, right? You think that, you know, that for the jet properties...
This tells me that the jets are important, that the size of the star is... that are always there, and the size of the star...
Star is controlled.
Yeah. This is a guess. So the guess is... Well, not a guess. I mean, from what we found here, we found this evidence in every time that it was possible to find this evidence. Whether this is really generic or not, we don't know. We have an example of just a few, the sample is just a few supernova. The good news is that with coming surveys like ZTF and so on, we will have much more data, much more early data on supernova. So within a year or two, this will be revealed whether this phenomena of high velocity material is common to all supernova or just a small fraction.
So in this case, if you observe from the own axis, even if they're almost spherical, I think the emission might be different, right? Because,
you know, it is possible that you'll have somewhat different emission, yeah. Actually, in 2008D, the cooling emission from this is what might have caused the first peak in 2008D. 2008D, the light curve is two peaks. The first peak is one day, and then a second peak. This might be the cause of the first peak.
So this cocoon structure may be aspherical, but to produce gravitational waves, the exposure would need to be non-axisymmetric. Why would that be the case?
But first thing first, the moment that you produce a relativistic jet, you produce gravitational waves. It's not in the LIGO. A GRB, by accelerating matter from zero to Lorentz factor of 200, produce gravitational waves. Unfortunately, they are in the 0.1 hertz typical frequency. So this is just from the fact that you have jets. But the fact that you have this very fast rotation means that the central engine of the supernova could be very different from the central engines that we think, what they think they are. And this opens now a whole set of possibilities. I'm old enough to remember the time that people were talking about supernova emitting 10 to the 51 hertz in gravitational waves because of instabilities.
Rahul said them.
How close must supernova be for one of these other systems.
What do you mean, how close? The distance?
Yes.
One of them was 8, this one was about 8 megaparsecs. So this was as close as it could be.
So you would suggest that something like 10 megaparsecs or 8 megaparsecs is the radius at which people should look for these kinds of systems?
Most of the supernovas here are not more than 20 or 30 megaparsecs.
Thank you.
You were saying something?
Yeah, she's going to present on your computer.
Yeah, sure.
She sent an email.
You sent an email, that's what I
did.